Welcome to AP Calculus BC. We've got 7.3 today, anti-differentiation by parts. Now, I'm going to try and make this video as quick as possible, but there is a lot of writing involved, and this is kind of a lengthy process, so organization is very important, and again, keeping all of our variables a lot like that integration by substitution or anti-differentiation by substitution that we had, keeping all the variables organized is a really important process here, because there is so much rewriting involved. We want to be sure that we're keeping our work in order. So again, I'll try and keep this as to the point as possible, but just be advised that these problems are kind of long ones. It is AP Calculus, by the way. So in section 7.2, we covered this anti-differentiation by substitution, and it was a great way to handle integrating anti-differentiation with the chain rule involved. Well, the product rule for differentiation, you remember, if we were trying to find the derivative of a product, in this case we've got two functions, u times v, well, that would be u dv plus v du, right? First d second plus second d first. Well, if we were to take that, and I'll spare you the proof here, like I said, I'm trying to be succinct, if we were to integrate both sides of that equation and rearrange the result, what we would end up with is a nice little way of looking at an integral. And so here we've got an integral of u dv, and you might be thinking, wow, how can we evaluate that integral if it's two separate variables there? What we're doing is we are rearranging our given integral into two parts, the u part, one function, and then the dv we're defining as something else. Well, then what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to take our u, we're going to have to take dv and anti-differentiate that to get from dv back to v, and that's something that we can handle. And then we're going to subtract away this integral with v that we found, and then du. So we're also going to have to derivate u in order to acquire this du term. But the idea is to take an integral that we cannot manage right off the bat, and then from that, run through this means of integrating the power rule to establish an integral that we can easily anti-differentiate. So we've got some parts that we can figure out, and then one integral that we can easily manage. So that is our goal today, put as quickly and succinctly as I can. All right, so our first example, we've got the integral of 2t cosine of 3t dt. And again, if you look at this, you might be tempted to try and set up that u du that we had by substitution, but it just doesn't work, right? We've got a 3t inside that cosine function, and the derivative of that is just 3. So how do we handle that extra t variable that's showing up in our integral? It can't be handled by substitution. So recall that if I want to find the integral of u dv, that's going to equal u times v minus the integral of v du. So in order to fill in this template that integration by parts is setting up for us, we need to look at our function and define a u and a dv. So that way, when we read that integral, it's no longer 2t cosine 3t dt, it's integral of u dv. And the way that we decide what part of our integral is going to be u, what part of it is dv, sometimes it doesn't make a difference, sometimes it does. So if you try and start working through a process with, okay, I'm going to let this be u, I'm going to let this be dv, and it doesn't work out, you get this integral over here that is no easier to manage. You're going to find that out pretty quickly, and you can go back and swap out what you called u, what you called dv. So we'll have some different examples this lesson that show changing that up in the most effective way. All right, so if u equals 2t, then du, the derivative of u, would be 2, and then that's with respect to t. So we can find that du. Again, we're going to need that eventually. It's going to be a part of our simpler integral. And then if dv is the cosine of 3t, well, that's something that's pretty easy to anti-differentiate. I've got a little chain rule to take care of with 1/3, and sine would derivate to cosine. So to antiderivate, we work that in the opposite direction. All right. So now let's plug this into the nice integration by parts formula. So the integral of 2t cosine of 3t, that's the one we're trying to find, that equals u times v. Okay, u is 2t times v is 1/3 sine of 3t minus, and then the integral I'm left with is v, 1/3 sine of 3t, times du, which was 2dt. And look at how nice that integral that we've set up with, or that we set up is, how easy that's going to be to manage, because now I've just got a sine function to anti-differentiate, and that is very manageable. That's showing us that integration by parts is working. All right, typically, you know, we try and shorthand this and work through it as quickly as possible. One method of simplifying, and you're going to want to simplify and rewrite with these problems, again, organization is key. Getting the constants out in front is going to be very, very helpful. So to rewrite this, instead of 2 times t times 1/3, I'm going to call that 2t over 3 sine of 3t. And then I've got some constants in here, a 1/3 and a 2. I can multiply those together and move those out in front of the integral, right? That's our constant multiple property of integration. So I've got 2/3 times the integral of sine 3t dt, and it just makes that integral all the more harmless, right? Okay, so we've got 2t over 3 sine of 3t. That hasn't changed at all. Minus 2/3 times, okay, if I'm going to anti-differentiate sine, well, the derivative of cosine is negative sine, so I need a negative cosine here. And we've got a chain rule that we have to take care of as well, so I need to multiply a 1/3 in there to counteract that chain rule. All right, and let's clean it up. We're actually done with this. 2t over 3 sine of 3t minus a negative, that's going to be plus, and then I've got 2/3 times a 1/3, that's 2/9 cosine of 3t. And you'll notice that this whole time I've taken a couple, or we've worked with this integral here and this integral here, two places that we've anti-differentiated, and we have not forgotten, but we've neglected to add plus c. Well, since c is some arbitrary constant, all of these arbitrary constants are going to accumulate and combine. So we are able to save that step until the very end, because we can just say that this c is the accumulation of all those other plus c's that we've acquired along the way. This is that indefinite integral. And if we wanted to confirm, we could go back and run through our derivation rules, and sure enough, we would get back to our integrand. Unfortunately, I've run out of room to do so. Let's try another one. As we look at letter B here, we've got t squared and natural log of t dt. So if you're thinking about it, well, how do I come up with something? Is it possible to anti-differentiate natural log? In other words, is there something whose derivative is natural log? And the answer is no. So if we're working with this natural log, the only thing we can do to that is derivate it. So that must be our u, right? Because we're going to have to find du. We can do that. If we called that dv, we could not anti-differentiate it. So t squared dt, that combined is going to be our dv. Okay, so I'm just going to rewrite that so it's a little cleaner. U is natural log t, dv is t squared dt. Well, then we're going to need du. Well, derivative of natural log is just 1 over t dt. And then if I anti-differentiate t squared, that is t cubed over 3. All right, so all those pieces are in place. My integral, keep doing that with the h's. Try and write ln too fast, end up making a lowercase h. Right, so our integral, when we break that down, we get u times v. I'm going to put the v in front just so I don't confuse that as being inside the argument of my natural log. So there's u times v minus the integral of v du. So t cubed over 3, du is 1 over t dt. And oh, look at that. That actually simplifies. I'm dividing out one of those t's. That integrand is actually t squared over 3. Okay. Well, my u times v, I've already got that simplified. And there's no constant term to pull out in front of our integral, you know, no simplifying to take shape there, which is good. That means it's simple to begin with, and it is. But if I were to anti-differentiate this, okay, it started off as something t cubed, and then they had to multiply 3 out front to end up with over 3. That means we had to start out with over 9. Tack on our plus c, constant of integration, and we've found that indefinite integral. All right, so how can we take this a step further? Well, differential equations, right? We talked about those in 7.1, those these equations that involve slopes, the derivatives, and when we graph them out, we get slope fields representing the family of solutions. Well, to actually solve this, what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to integrate this, right, to undo the derivative work, find out what the original function is. And because that original function will have a plus c at the end, we're going to have to use this initial condition to solve for c, find out what that constant at the end is to get our definitive solution. All right, so I'm trying to take the indefinite integral, x cubed natural log x dx. All right, just like the last example, this natural log x must take the place of u, and the x cubed dx, that will be our dv. So u is natural log x, dv is x cubed dx. Then du, which we'll also need to integrate by parts, that's going to be 1 over x dx. And regular old v, that's going to be x to the 4th over 4. Undoing the power rule. All right, so the integral itself, I'm going to have to write kind of small here. The integral itself, well, here, why don't I just move over like that. U times v, x to the 4th over 4 natural log x minus the integral v du. And we get the same situation that we saw in the last example. That's going to become x cubed over 4, making that integrand much easier to work with. So that integral, x to the 4th over 4 natural log x, nothing to clean up there, minus, and we've got x to the 4th over 16 plus c. So that's what we're working with to start with. That's our family of functions that satisfies that differential equation. Now it's time to solve for c. Well, the function z equals 5. So really, I could have called that integral the function z. And z equals 5 when x equals 1. So 5 equals 1 to the 4th over 4 times the natural log of 1. Ooh, anytime I see natural log or any logarithm with 1 as an argument, I know that term is 0, minus 1 16th plus c. So if I'm going to solve that for c, all I need to do is add this 1 16th to both sides. Okay, and 5 is 80 16ths, so that would make 81 16ths equal to that c value. So the solution to this differential equation is z equals x to the 4th over 4 natural log x minus x to the 4th over 16 plus 81 16ths. And it says to confirm this by evaluating the slope field of the differential equation, I've used a slope field plotter and then plotted our solution over top. And you can see that the function that we've arrived at when going through the 0.15 certainly does obey the flow of our slope field very, very nicely. Just taking familiar territory with antiderivatives, with integrals, and with differential equations, and kind of putting it all together using this new parts technique. Really is very little new material. All right, so this next example, we're going to try and take the integral 2x root x plus 2, and you know what? Right now I'm going to write that as to the 1/2 power. Easier to work with powers, of course, dx. All right, and if I try and do, let's think, okay, which one of those is going to be easier to anti-differentiate? And just think, if I were to take this x plus 2 to the 1/2 power dx, if I were going to try and derivate that, I would end up with a radical in the denominator. I would end up with still more square roots and stuff. It would not get much simpler. So that's telling me that this should be my dv and that 2x should be the u. Well, 2x is the u. That means that du is simply 2 with the x differential there. And then v, if I anti-differentiate that, that's going to stay relatively clean, right? It's just a power rule I have to undo. It's especially nice because we just have a plain x inside. There's no chain rule to account for either. So I have 2/3 x plus 2 to the 3/2 is that antiderivative. All right, let's put it together. So this integral equals u times v. All right, so we got 2x times 2/3 x plus 2 to the 3/2 minus the integral of v du. 2/3 x plus 2 to the 3/2 times du was 2 dx. And again, we've got that function that's raised to a rational exponent, that integral looks pretty manageable, especially with all the constants that we can move out front. Let's do that now. So I can clean up this first term, call it 4x over 3 times x plus 2 to the 3/2. Minus, let's move our constants, this 2/3 times 2. Let's move that. It's a 4/3 product. Move that out in front of the integral. And now we just have x plus 2 to the 3/2 dx to integrate, and that should be a pretty easy one, right? Just a power rule. That equals 4x over 3. This first term is already pretty sparkling, right? It's set to go. And I got minus 4/3 times, to anti-differentiate that integrand, it had to start off as a 5/2 power, so we're going to multiply 2/5, the reciprocal out front to counteract that, times x plus 2 to the 5/2 power. Okay, and then we're going to have our constant of integration at the end. It's just a little cleanup now. 4x over 3, x plus 2 to the 3/2, minus, this is going to be 8/15, x plus 2 to the 5/2, plus c. And it's all cleaned up, and now it's time to find out what is that c value. So this function that we've just created is y, right? We've undone that derivative through our anti-differentiation by parts. And it says y equals 0 when x equals negative 1. So 0 equals negative 4/3 times negative 1 plus 2. That's just 1 to the 3/2. It'll just be 1. Minus 8/15 times 1 to the 5/2, that will just be 1, plus c. So all I've got to do is combine these together and add them over to the other side of the equal sign, and I'm going to find that c equals, let's see, that would be 20/15 plus 8 fifteenths, 28 fifteenths. So our final function for y, the specific solution we've arrived at, is that y equals 4x over 3 times x plus 2 to the 3 halves minus 8 fifteenths times x plus 2 to the 5 halves plus 28 fifteenths. And again, turning to some graphing software to plot the slope field and then our solution function on top yields this result. And you can see, sure enough, our slope field certainly does conform to that function that we've entered. And you can see that point A, that's our given initial condition. Good, again, nothing really new here except to get to the antiderivative. In order to solve for C, we had to use integration by parts. Or antidifferentiation by parts, and that's the new concept, just how it ties in. All right, this next example is quite possibly the largest bear in the whole lesson. We've got two functions, and if you look at them, e to the negative x, we've got an e exponential function, and then sine of 2x, a sine function. Think about as we derivate and anti-differentiate these, there's no end, right? I can't derivate something towards zero. I can't derivate something with any end in sight. They just kind of oscillate around. So how we handle this is we still do our u substitution, or not substitution, sorry. We still set up our u and our dv. And for this example, I've chosen e to the negative x as being u. And the sine of 2x dx, that will be dv. So that would mean that du equals negative e to the negative x dx. And then v, the antiderivative of sine, well, the derivative of cosine is negative sine. So I've got negative 1/2 cosine of 2x. Again, that negative 1/2 is important because that allows us to undo the chain rule when we derivate. Okay, so our integral equals u times v, e to the negative x times negative 1/2 cosine of 2x minus the integral v du, which is negative 1/2 cosine of 2x times negative e to the negative x dx. And you can see that integral that we've come up with, boy, it's not much better than what we started with. But we're solving for the unknown integral. That is this guy. The unknown integral is what we started with. So what I want to do is, I want to end up creating that integral again, and that's going to use this repeating pattern that e to the x and sine of x, that those kind of oscillating, just never ending, there's no differential end to them. So I'm going to go through this process again. So let's switch colors here. And actually, before I do that, I'm going to clean this up. So I've got negative e to the negative x over 2 times cosine of 2x. And that first term's not going to change, right? It's good. I don't have any more work to do with that. It's this other integral that's going to have more work involved. So I'm going to yank out this negative 1/2 and this negative sign from e to the negative x there. And so I'll still have a negative. I'll have a 1/2 times the integral of e to the negative x times cosine of 2x dx. And you can see how that integral is starting to look more and more like the integral we started with. Well, if we try the same process again, let's let e to the negative x be u, cosine of 2x dx this time, that will be our dv. That means that du, once again, will be negative e to the negative x dx, and v will equal, well, derivative of sine is cosine, so this will be 1/2 sine of 2x when we account for the chain rule. All right, so that negative e to the negative x, this whole term It's along for the ride, right? It's already been anti-differentiated. That part has been handled. Minus 1/2. And I want to keep track of this because that negative 1/2 is going to distribute. So I'm going to make note of that right here. So I've got u times v, e to the negative x times 1/2 sine of 2x minus the integral of v du, 1/2 sine of 2x, and then du, negative e to the negative x dx. And look how close that integral has become to being our starting integral. That is the whole point. I want to make this integral a like term with what I started with, what's still kind of lingering over on the other side of the equal sign. Then I can combine like terms and solve for it. So in a weird way, this is like doing a simple algebra problem, like 3x equals 2x minus 7. We just want to minus 1. We just want to combine like terms, except instead of x, we've got a monstrous integral. So once again, let's clean this up. So I'm going to extract this 1/2. Oh, I got to remember that whole thing is having this negative 1/2 applied to it, and extract this negative sign. Let's rewrite the whole stinking thing. Why not? Oh, I had a 1/2 that I can move out front here, too. I'm going to extract this 1/2 from that sine of 2x, make it 1/4 e to the negative x sine of 2x. Okay, so I've already distributed this negative 1/2 to this first term. So then I've got negative 1/2 still hanging on here, and that's going to multiply with this negative and this negative coming out as well. So a lot to handle. We got a positive 1/2, but then the negative comes out from that negative e to the negative x. That's going to create, let's see, negative, negative, positive, negative there. So negative 1/4. And then I've got my integral e to the negative x sine of 2x dx. All right, so we distributed that negative 1/2. That kind of happened off the cuff there. I hope you were able to follow and see how we arrived at what we did here. Now, all we're going to do is take this term, and remember, this is the equivalent of saying negative 1/4 x, and over here we've already got an x. We've already got that integral e to the negative x. We already have that like term established over here. If I add 1/4 over to this side, I will have 5/4 of that integral. So 5/4 of that equals, and then look at what's left over. We've got this left over. Is there any way we could make that simpler looking? And the answer is definitely yes, we can. I'm going to take out a negative 1/4 e to the negative x. Okay, and it doesn't look like it's possible, but I can factor out a 1/4 from that cosine of 2x term. Just think of it as undistributing. That means we started with 2 cosine of 2x. Okay, and then all that's left over on the in our second term here is just sine of 2x. Oop, let's close that up. And then the last thing we need to do, undo this 4/5, right? We want to solve for this integral alone, so we multiply both sides by 4/5, the reciprocal. So get that to cancel. And what we're left with, I'm multiplying and dividing by 4. Final solution, holy cow, is negative e to the negative x over 5 times the quantity 2 cosine 2x plus sine of 2x. Okay, and we factored all that out, so it is distributing. Let's close up that quantity. And then, of course, the obligatory plus C at the end. Wow. Just makes you feel good when you finish a problem like that, doesn't it? Okay, I hope you're answering yes to that question. Now, we saw the repeating nature of that last example, and there's a way, there's definitely a pattern to how repeatedly integrating, repeatedly differentiating these types of problems works. And there's a tabular method to handle a function, but it has to take a specific form. So if we have a product of two functions that we're trying to integrate, and one of those functions can be differentiated to zero. So it's like a polynomial function that as we keep taking derivatives, it will lead down to zero. And g of x can be easily anti-differentiated repeatedly. So one of those like trig functions or something with a negative exponent like x to the negative first, we can keep differentiating that. Obviously e to the x, another good example there. This method makes short work and does a much better job of organizing that work as we go along. So let's try this method. Remember, it only works in those specific cases. So in example four, we can see that we've got one part of our integrand, one factor of our integrand is the function x squared minus 5x. That one can easily be differentiated to zero. So I'm going to make one column of this table devoted to doing just that. I'm going to start off with f of x, then take its derivative, then take that derivative, and keep doing so until I work my way down to zero. Going all the way back to, I think it was chapter three on our test, where we had problems where we had to differentiate and all the way down until we reached a zero. This is why. The other piece can easily be anti-differentiated repeatedly. It's just e to the x. So I start off with e to the x. If I were to undo the derivation process, I would get another e to the x, and so on, and so on. So how this works is we're going to take the product of f of x and the derivative or antiderivative of g of x, and this is just fast-tracking that process of integration by parts. So that's going to be positive. The next term will be a negative term, 2x minus 5 times e to the x, and then I'm going to keep doing this until all of my integrals have an arrow pointing at them. And that will be positive. You're going to love this. So our function, our antiderivative, you can believe this, x squared minus 5x times e to the x minus, right, that next term is negative, 2x minus 5 times e to the x plus 2 times e to the x. All right, let's clean this up. We could factor out an e to the x. And once I've done that, I get x squared minus 5x, and then a negative distributing to 2x and to negative 5, and then a plus 2, e to the x, it's x squared minus 7x plus 7. That quantity, of course, add our constant of integration. We are done. Right, now, if you had gone the u and dv route, you would have reached this conclusion as well, obviously, but just think of all the rewriting and cleaning up that you would have to do along the way. This tabular method really does a nice job of condensing that workload, keeping it nice and organized. But again, it only works for that specific pattern where one factor in this product of two functions, one of those functions can be differentiated to zero, the other we can anti-differentiate repeatedly and easily. Right. Example five, here we've got a definite integral, right? And then we're supposed to support our answer using our calculator. Of course, you know, f and int can handle this right away. But we just learned this really, really nice integration by parts method, let's put it to use and then apply it to this definite integral. All right, well, I notice upon looking at it that, hey, I can take that x cubed and I can repeatedly differentiate that until it reaches zero. And this cosine function, if I were to antiderivate that, I could do so repeatedly, right? That function oscillates continuously. So f of x, we start off with x cubed, derivate it, I get 3x squared. Getting ahead of myself here. Then 6x, and then 6, and then 0. Maybe I'm covering too much space here. G of x, we start off with cosine of 2x. If I anti-differentiate that, I get sine of 2x, but 1 half because of the chain rule. If I anti-differentiate that, I get negative 1 fourth cosine of 2x, right? Multiplying another 1 half out front to account for the chain rule, and of course the negative sign. Okay, then I've got negative 1 eighth sine of 2x, and finally positive 1 16th cosine 2x. Okay, so draw in our arrows and apply the signs like so. So what we have right here is, let's see if we can condense this pretty quickly here. I've got x cubed times 1 half sine x. So x cubed over 2 sine of, I think I said x, 2x. It's our first term. Then minus a negative, so that will be plus, and 3x squared times 1 fourth cosine 2x. 3x squared over 4 cosine of 2x. All right, then I got plus a negative 6x times 1 eighth sine 2x, so that will be a negative term overall because of the negative that was already there. 6 over 8, 3 fourths, and there was an x in there, sine of 2x. And lastly, we are going to subtract 6 sixteenths, which is 3 eighths, cosine of 2x. And we are going to evaluate that from 0 to pi over 2. Now, before I start evaluating this and start plugging in pi over 2s, man, I see some like terms there. I think I could factor this by grouping, just make it easier to input values. So let's see what we got. We've got a cosine 2x term. And what's multiplying into cosine 2x? Well, 3x squared over 4. And we've also got a minus 3 eighths. All right, now let's do the same thing with sine. So plus my sine of 2x term, I'm going to undistribute that, and I get an x cubed over 2 minus 3x over 4. And not really much of a change, but it's one that is really going to make it easier for me to plug in values because there are fewer places to do so. And also, along with that, fewer chances to make a mistake. So, at pi over 2, evaluating this at its upper bound, cosine at 2 times pi over 2, that's the cosine at pi. Well, cosine at pi is negative 1. So negative 1, and if I plug in pi over 2, I've got 3 times pi over 2 squared. That's 3 times pi squared over 4, and then I'm dividing it by 4 again, 3 pi squared over 16 minus my 3 eighths, plus sine at 2 times pi over 2, that's sine at pi. Oh, that whole other term is 0. Oh, I'm happy to see that. Now let's evaluate at our lower bound. We'll do that one in red. So at 0, first I've got the cosine at 0, which is a positive 1, times, and if I plug in 0, 3 x squared, that term disappears, right? Because I'm plugging in a 0, I've just got that negative 3 eighths. Okay, and then plus, let's take a look at the sine term here. Sine at 2 times 0, well, the sine at 0 is 0 as well. Whew, that's nice. Now, to bring it all together and actually close this, we got to take the antiderivative with the upper bound plugged in. Let's go ahead and distribute that negative. That's negative 3 pi squared over 16 plus 3 eighths. And then we subtract away the antiderivative with the lower bound plugged in. So I'm subtracting away a negative 3 eighths. All right, so final answer when we bring this all together, negative 3 pi squared. Okay, and I got plus 3 eighths plus another 3 eighths. That's 6 eighths or 12 sixteenths. So I'm going to say plus 12 all over 16. And there's our exact answer. Finally, a nice long journey to get there. And then it says to compare the answer with fn int. Well, if we typed this answer in to get a decimal approximation, we get approximately negative 1.10055. And if you were to do fn int, I can assure you, if we integrated this using fn int right away, we would get the exact same result. Very neat. Very neat. All right, example six. Last one, solve the differential equation, and oh, thank you. This is one that you can tell follows that pattern as well. So we've got one function within our integrand that can be differentiated to zero. Let's go ahead and do that. The other one can be repeatedly antidifferentiated, so we can use that tabular method. Start off with x to the fourth, 4x cubed, 12x squared, 24x, 24, 0. Okay, it's kind of a long list, but still a lot better than repeatedly using parts. G of x, it's going to start off as e to the 2x. To anti-differentiate, we do have a chain rule, so keep that in mind. 1 half e to the 2x, 1 fourth e to the 2x, 1 eighth e to the 2x. Not negative, 1 16th e to the 2x. And lastly, 1 32nd. I need one more to complete that column. 1 32nd e to the 2x. All right, let's draw in our arrows and appropriate the signs. All right, and the rest of it's just putting it all together and cleaning it up. So our function, the solution here, y, is equal to x to the fourth times 1 half e to the 2x minus 4x cubed times 1 fourth. Nice, that's just x cubed e to the 2x. Okay, then we got plus 12 over 8. That's 3 halves x squared e to the 2x. And next one, we got 24 sixteenths, also 3 halves. This one's negative, though. X e to the 2x. And our final term, 24 32nds. This one, what we got, 3 fourths? Yeah. Oop, it's positive. Plus 3 fourths e to the 2x. All right, we can clean that up by factoring out an e to the 2x. X to the fourth over 2, x cubed, 3x squared over 2, minus 3x over 2, plus 3 fourths, add our plus c, and we've got it. So a long lesson, definitely a thorough lesson, a lot of a lot of writing involved, but again, I hope if one thing can be imparted from watching this lesson, it's the importance of keeping everything organized. Really, all we are doing is adding a new method to handle a situation that we couldn't integrate. And so it's a new set of steps to handle a different type of integral. But other than that, it's accomplishing the same thing. It's antiderivating. So I hope you've taken something away from this lesson. I hope we practice it and come back with questions. Here's a look at your assignment. I do have one adjustment to make. I forgot to change this on the slide before recording here. We're going to skip problem number 31. We're going to skip problem 31. I'm sure that skipping one of these problems with all the writing is nothing that you're all too upset about. That does it for section 7.3.